Yes, hi. My name is Yemi Balogun, and welcome once again to this wonderful interview that's been put together for the Embassy of God in Kiev. And it's designed to actually check the background of Pastor Sunday Adelaja, because you see him do wonderful things, and you're wondering, you see God wondering, where did he start from? How did he get where he is right now? What can we learn from him to enable us to do exploits? Just like he said, you know what? Try and make sure you get the complete series, complete set of this interview. It will bless you. It will transform your lives. It would actually also help members of your congregation to love God more, to serve him in spirit and in truth, and also make sure that their lives are never the same. Because the Bible says creation is waiting for the God. God bless you as you continue to watch.
So this time that I was in the underground church with all this group of people, that was the period for my personal transformation. I was a believer, zealous for the Lord. I was taught the fear of God in deeper life and holiness. But also in that church, I picked up some religious understanding of holiness. And all the people who came from those churches, deeper life, and other religious churches, you couldn't survive it in Russia. Most of them, maybe 99% of them, more percentage of them backslided. So I was a candidate to backslide. But because I was only 6 months, because the way we practiced the religion that time in Nigeria was that it was very rigid. And if you are going to be rigid, not on the word of God, but rigid on law, on religious stuff, you were not even going to survive it at all. For example, some of the only Christians you have the opportunity to see there, they are not the kind of Christians that you are used to. For example, when I go to meet some of these Christians who were meeting together in the underground church, the leader of that fellowship that time, we went to the fellowship underground. Then just before the meeting began, I saw him, he picked up a perfume. And then just applied perfume to his armpit and something. When I saw that, I said, my God, these people are not born again. These people are not saved. So I had that kind of religious understanding of holiness. I said, this man is not saved. Then when I entered his room, I came to visit him one day, I saw television. I said, so I'm going to be the only one in this country. Then when I began to listen to him, so I began to have a conflict in me that, how can this man know so much of God, so much Bible? He was so deep in the things of God. I mean, he had survived 8 years in Russia and I had not survived 8 months. And he was such a fiery, loving brother. I'd never seen such a loving heart in my life up to that moment. And then, in my own understanding, he's not born again. Then the two girls we had from Kenya, they had earrings and jewelry, and then they had their hair well-made Jerry coin and all kind of coins and curls. And, from the place I was coming from, I thought, these ones are not even sisters at all. So I needed 3 to 4 years to get myself readjusted. So God was working on me those times of, so I was learning afresh to see how God sees. To see that when I see somebody, like with Jericho before, I would have said this, and I would have called them off. See, these are not Christians, or these are not, cannot be accepted. Even if they are not, but transformation was happening within me to see that people are different and people are Christians. People, God looks at the heart. I didn't know all those things. I just loved everything I saw in that church at the beginning. So my religious part was being broken, reshaped. God was remolding me. So it didn't take God long because I was not in the system for too long. But the guys who were in the same city with me were coming to me and saying, oh, we used to go to Deeper Life, or we used to go to this church, or we used to go to that. But we will come back because they couldn't, because they were too rigid, then they didn't know when they started falling. because they thought that a little compromise was going to, for example, if my, the same thing would have happened to me. Yeah. For example, one, I will give you this story. One day in my class, we did exam, and we have people from different countries. They put you together from people. We had people, in that university, we had people from 99 countries. And so there were two girls from Cyprus or Greece. So they were from Europe. So it happened that I got the best mark in the class. And this girl from Greece or Cyprus also got at the top mark, I and her. So when she got to know that I got the same mark like her, she came jumping and she was so happy. And then she just came and hugged me. You know, she hung on my neck. And you know, when a woman is embracing you, you know, my chest touched her chest, that, you know. And I said, "But I am backslidden."
You're backslidden already.
I am backslidden. You know, because, you know, there are, you know, chemical reactions in the body. And so I was like, "My God, what part of it was that?" I went to the hotel, I went back to my room. And I was weeping and regretting and just, how could this happen to me? I'm a Christian, I'm backsliding. And I didn't pray that night. Then I woke up the next morning, I was afraid of going to God, I've offended God, I'm backsliding. Look at what religion could do to you. I would say, how could this, because I was even not condemning the girl, I was condemning my feeling. How could I have feeling? How could that thing happen to me? The next morning I woke up, I was ashamed of going to pray. I say, I've disappointed God. I let God down. I let God down. It's religion. Then the next day, I also woke up. Because the last night, I couldn't pray again. So when I woke up the next day, God said, if you don't pray today, you will never pray again in your life.
Wow.
That fear will lead you away, and you will say, this is not me. This is religion that is bringing condemnation to you. It is Satan that is the accuser of the brethren. I'm not the accuser. I convinced, but I don't accuse. So you are being accused. It is not me. If you don't repent now, even if you feel that you are wrong, or you feel that you have done something wrong, you have to repent. Never live in condemnation. That condemnation would have drawn you away from me. I say, I never heard of that kind of message or revelation before.
Wow.
I just fell down. Repented for what I was feeling. I said, well, you didn't even do anything wrong. But because of the religion or something. So for example, in that, because I was coming from a church where I couldn't even shake the hand of a sister. And here somebody was hanging on my neck. You see the contrast?
Serious.
And that was happening every day, all my life, that is happening all the time. So considering the society I was living in, God needed to break me and set me free from things like that. Then, of course, then summer came. The first summer, my first summer in Europe, when you go everywhere, we have beaches in the city. We're just near my dormitory, there are beaches. You look under the window, there are beaches. And the beaches, the ladies are not wearing, you know, they're just wearing bikini and they are, you know, top. Some don't wear top. And you need to survive. So God brought me through all that, just to remold me also, to change my mindset, to see not as man see, to see not just from seeing the world, not from the window of sin, not seeing the world from judgmental position, or from the position of sin only, or judgmental, but seeing with the eyes of Christ, with the eyes of redemption, and the eyes of love, and with the eyes of compassion, rather than from the eyes of with the eyes of sin, condemnation, and judgment. So that was the work God was doing with me in the initial years. So later on, when I became the leader of this fellowship, but there were only white black people in this fellowship. So the other students had gone, and I became the leader. And I was worried, and I started challenging myself that if I came here to Europe, all these Russians, because that time when they removed Jesus Christ from my wall, he said, let them remove him, because you still need to learn things from them. You need to learn the language. You need to learn their system, because I will use you to still change their mind, to still touch them. So I was saying, but this is a fellowship, only foreigners are here. We're afraid that they will kill us, and they will know. The KGB will know. So I started getting concerned that how could I find a way of reaching out to these Russian people and you know, bringing the real gospel to them. So at that point, I was determined to see the power of God. So that's how the zeal started coming up in me. So I told one of the guys who was in the fellowship with me, I said, please meet with me every day. We'll pray apart from our own personal time with God. Let's meet every day to pray for 2 hours. Every day, just for revival. It was so difficult. We were schooling, we were going to library, we were doing homework, we were doing projects. But you know, we tried our best and we did that for 1 year. By the end of that 1 year, heaven just broke open over us. Revival and the Spirit of God just fell over the fellowship. People started getting baptized in the Holy Spirit. Even me, I was not baptized in the Holy Spirit for 4 years because I left home 6 months a believer. And in the church that I got born again, they said you needed to go through sanctification before you get baptism of Holy Spirit. So when I just got born again, I had not graduated from the born again stage to sanctification. That sanctification had not attained the top level of Holy Spirit baptism. So I came to Russia, no Holy Spirit baptism. It almost killed me. Wow. But here, Holy Spirit just came down. You know, who does baptize in the Holy Spirit? You know, and all these people started, fire began to burn, and we started going to Russian churches, to villages, to these churches, and started praying. Miracles, supernatural started exploding. You know, the communists couldn't get us. The Russians were hiding us, and we started seeing the miraculous power of God. That was when I was inspired so much that through my own eye, I could see God walking through me. Cancer going, lumps disappearing. Not even praying for them, not even laying hands on them, just praying from the stage. And everywhere we go, to people who are looking for us, people who have been laid out to die, were coming up to life. That was when I began to say, oh, wow. So this could happen to me. But it's a confirmation of an encounter I had with God just 1 month after I came to Russia.
Wow.
In that encounter, I had met this man that I said was using perfume and had television in his room. So I was telling him, there are no believers here and things are so tough for me. No church, no school, no believers. And I needed to learn the language. Things were so rough. And I was telling him, I showed him my admission to go to America. And I showed him my admission to University of Ife. And I said, I still have the admission. The letter from America was still with me. I said, I still have this admission. Maybe I could transfer or go back home. I was so frustrated because things were so difficult for me. So then he began to speak to me and said, you know, God doesn't do anything without a purpose. That if God allows you to come here, it means he has a purpose for it. So he was the one who told me, you know what? Since you are so frustrated and you don't know what is happening, I challenge you to seek God and throw him a challenge to tell you why he brought you here. So I didn't know how to do that, but I just said, okay, I'm going to do it. So I was praying before I go to bed. All my prayers will be about, God, tell me, why did you bring me here? When I woke up in the morning, I would pray the same thing. Why did you bring me here? This man said that, I said, you don't do anything without purpose. I never had such a statement before in my life, that you always do something with purposes. What purpose is behind my coming here? So I did that for 2 weeks, praying day and night. Before I ate, I would pray that prayer. God, open to me. Why? What is the purpose for you bringing me here? At the end of 2 weeks of praying, one day, as I was sleeping, I saw Jesus coming to me in the dream and took me into a crusade ground. And I saw myself ministering in auditoriums all over, everywhere. Then the next day, the same thing repeated itself. The same thing. Then the third day, the same thing. Jesus came. But what happened the third day? I'm still seeing, I could see it as clearly as I'm looking at you now. Jesus walked into my room again, picked me up, and took me to a stage. On that stage, there were great men of God ministering to a crowd of like 200,000 people. But they were all white people. Like, I was used to seeing a crusade, like Bunky, black people, like Kumuyi, the stadium. But this was all white people. And I saw one great man of God, the one I knew from Africa, ministering on that stage. And I, with they were already ministering before I and Jesus came. When I and Jesus walked to the stage, I was standing just beside him, and this people man was still ministering. Then Jesus just touched the shoulder of that man and said, you have motioned to him to give the microphone to me. So the man handed over the microphone to me and stepped backward. So I started ministering. And then I saw myself calling out diseases like with word of knowledge in the auditorium with all these white people and 200 crowd of people, no end to it. Then as I was calling out the sicknesses, people started throwing out wheelchairs and you know canes, and miracles started happening. And I knew this is what is waiting for me. Then I just woke up. As I woke up, I was so frightened because it has repeated itself for 3 nights. But this one was the most, I still remember the suit I was wearing in that dream. It was so clear, like nature. So when I woke up, I was saying, hey, I need confirmation, because I came from a church where they said, don't be in a hurry to believe prophecies and things. You must try everything.
Yes.
So I said, I must get a word of God for this thing. I must get confirmation. So when I opened the Bible, then something just told me, open the Bible. But in that church where I got born again, they said, never open the Bible, spontaneously.
Don't just open anyhow, just spontaneous.
Don't open Bible like that. Let the Spirit of God lead you. But this particular time, I felt I just have to open spontaneous. Just something, just open it anywhere. When I opened it the first time, I opened to Isaiah 61. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. And all that. And I never knew. I was only 6 months in the Lord. I never knew that was in Isaiah. I knew that was in Luke somewhere or in the New Testament, but I never knew it was in Isaiah. So when I saw the whole picture, the whole passage of it in Isaiah, I was so shocked that so this thing is in the Bible. It's in the Old Testament. But as I was reading it, it was saying, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. It was like every word was leaping off from the scripture. It was like it was becoming like a thousand tide of water. It was like it filled the whole room. And it was like a big voice saying, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. It was entering every cell of my bone. It was entering every part of me. The Spirit of the Lord God. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. For he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. Heal the sick. And heal the brokenhearted and all. Just kept on going. Just like the whole, it was like a thousand voices calling out, saying the Spirit of God and all this. And until the end of it, I said, I've never seen, and all my roommates were sleeping. And nobody was hearing all this thing. I said, wow, this is impossible. I closed it again. I started weeping and crying. I don't know what's happening to me, Lord. He said, open it again. This voice was saying, open it, not a voice, but just from inside me. Open it again. I opened it again. Then it went to Jeremiah chapter 1. So my eyes just fell on verse 4 that said, don't say I'm too young. That, you know, the word of the Lord came to me, that don't say I'm too young. And that I will put my word in your mouth. And that, you know, what you will plant and you will uproot and all, it just came on and done. And I was thinking in my heart that time, but I'm too young. I'm just 19. I can't do this. But just say, open to that. Yeah, I opened to Jeremiah. It just opened to Jeremiah, where I'm too young. Then you will plant and you will uproot. You will destroy kingdoms and you will come against kingdoms. They will fight against you. They will not overcome you. The old chapter 1. I said, wow. I just knew. I was seeing a picture of what was waiting for me, that a hard life is waiting for me because they were going to fight against me and I'm going to uproot and I'm going to plant new things. And I just could imagine bad, hard life waiting for me in the ministry. But he was saying they would not overcome you. Then after that, he said, close it again. I close it again. Then I open it again. Then I open to Habakkuk chapter 2. And my eyes went to chapter, verse 1 and 2. He said, I was on the hill or something, or waiting, and the voice of the Lord came to me or something like that, that write this vision down. That it, even though it might not, you know, it might take a while, it might tarry, but it will definitely come to pass. I said, eh? I should write it down. So I picked my notebook. I knew it was talking to me. So I picked my notebook. I quickly wrote everything down. So after, when I wrote everything down, I said I couldn't wait till the classes were over that day. I began to look for the leader of the of this our group, and I went to meet him, and he just said he was just smiling as he was hearing me. He said, "I was waiting for you." So he looked into it. He just stood up, looked into his shelf, and brought an exercise a notebook exercise book out. And in that exercise book, he had written. He said, "Look at this. What is the date?" I said, "Oh, today's morning, 2 o'clock in the morning, 2 a.m. He said, "You see, he wrote there, God just woke me up between 2 and 3 to write this prophecy down for a member of the fellowship." And everything that God spoke to me, everything I experienced, God gave him the same thing to write it down. So he said, "Well, this is for you. Take care. You are 19, you are young, but value what God has done. God just came to me and gave me this prophecy to give to a member of the fellowship."
Well, that was Pastor Sunday Adelaja, the senior pastor of the Embassy of God in Kiev in Ukraine, talking about his life, talking about the encounters he had with God and how he established a relationship with God, a relationship that you and I really want to establish as well, so that God can use us in our generation to affect lives. So you can actually order these materials from, you know, the website of the Embassy of God, so you can go through them and use them to prepare yourself for your own encounter. God bless you as you continue to love God.